Satya, I hope my voice is clear, right? There is no disturbances.
Satya, is it okay? You can hear us? Satya? Satya, can you hear us?
Oh yeah, actually somehow connection lost. Yeah, I'm able to hear now. Yep. Yeah.
Vijay, you can take up the things from here.
Yeah, yeah, I'll take up the things. Okay, Satya, so we'll talk about EBS today, okay?
Okay.
So as far as EBS is considered, so first I'll talk about the theoretical stuff, so then we will jump on to the practical things of EBS. See, actually EBS stands for Elastic Block Storage. So this one is a block storage service which is present in AWS, okay?
Mm-hmm.
When I say block storage, actually this is like, it is a persistent storage also. It's actually a persistent storage. So we do not want to worry about the data which is stored inside the EBS volumes, okay? So you can create an EBS volume and you can attach this EBS volume to any EC2 instance. Okay, but only one at a time. Only one EC2 instance at a time. Because as I said yesterday, it is like an internal hard disk. EBS is like an internal hard disk of our PC. Okay, so when you... When you purchase an EBS instance from AWS, okay, so AWS will give us a raw block storage device.
Mm-hmm.
Raw block storage. So what is the meaning of the word raw? It means this will not be in any format. Meaning it will not be in any file system.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So it is no file system device. Okay. So this raw block device, see, for example, you want to attach an EBS volume to a Windows instance that you have taken.
Mm-hmm.
Then you have to attach in the location of /dev/SDA. Okay. If you are purchasing and attaching an EBS volume to a Linux instance, then that should be in /dev/XPDA. So what is this? This is actually the format type, the type of formatting of this particular raw blocks, block devices. Okay. So after you attach a Windows or a Linux instance, then you have to either format it with the help of an NTFS operating system, NTFS file format, or a EXT file format based on your requirement. Okay, so as I said, you can attach one EBS volume to one EC2 instance only. Okay, but one EC2 instance can have multiple EBS volumes.
Okay.
Okay. So AWS recommends you can have up to 10 volumes attached to your single EC2 instance. They recommend that if you add more than 10 volumes, then the input output operations per second, the retrieval speed may reduce. Okay, they are not recommending any more than 10 volumes. They are recommending only up to 10. Okay, so practically, people are not using more than 8. People are stopping the number of EBS volumes added to a single instance by 8 itself. Okay, they are not moving more than that. Okay. Now, see, now for example, this is my, I have a region. So this is my region. Inside my region, I have availability zone 1 and I have availability zone 2. Availability zone 2. Now here I have a data center. This availability zone has 2 data centers and this availability zone also has 2 data centers. Okay, so now for example, I'm creating my EC2 instance on availability zone 1. Okay, and Amazon is giving us a space on the first data center. Now your volume should also be created on the same availability zone only. Your volume can be here or your volume can be here. Your volume cannot be here actually. Okay, so your EC2 instance and your volume should be on the same availability zone only. It cannot be in 2 different availability zones. Okay, even though they are connected with a high bandwidth link, till now, AWS do not support multi-tenant hard disks. All EC2 instances will work only on a single-tenant hard disk. Okay, so there is no concept of NAS storage as far as AWS is concerned. But if you talk about the traditional private cloud model, if you're talking about VDI setup, virtual desktop interface setup, here you can have NAS storage. Okay, so you can have storage on one single location and you can have devices on multiple other locations. So all the devices can access this storage from one NAS. This can be done only on the VDI, on the traditional virtualization setup. But as far as AWS is considered, not only AWS, any cloud platform, even like Azure also the case is same, Google also the same, the case is same, Alibaba also the case is same. Okay.
Okay. Hello.
Yeah. I'm there.
Oh,
so
okay.
This EBS. So it has a failure rate of 0.1% to 0.2% per year. Okay. This is the theoretical failure rate which Meha has given. Till now, like actually there was a failure only one time. The failure happened in 2017 actually. In 2017, mm-hmm. What happened is like, you know, especially the servers in North Virginia region got stopped. Due to some reason, the servers were not operational. So at that time, no one was able to access their resources. No one was able to launch their instances. It happened in 2017. After this, for next 3 years, nothing has been reported as far as AWS is concerned. Okay, so the failure rate is just a theoretical value here.
Okay.
So there are 3 types of EBS volumes that we can go ahead and purchase as far as AWS is considered. Okay, the first one is magnetic drives. The second one is hard disks. And the third one is solid state drives. Okay, 3 types.
Mm-hmm.
This 3 types is again divided into 5 types. Okay, magnetic, there is no division. Magnetic is called as magnetic only. In hard disk, we have something called as throughput hard disk, or we can say it is throughput optimized hard disks and cold hard disks. Okay, in SSDs, again SSD is classified into 2. One is general purpose SSD. The other one is provisional SSD. Or provisioned IOPS SSD. That's how they call it. Okay. Now, as I said yesterday, see, for example, now you are purchasing a Windows instance. You are booting a Windows instance. Now, this Windows OS can be installed only on a root volume, correct? That is called as a root volume. Where the place where you have installed your Windows is called as a root volume. Now, this root volume cannot be a throughput HDD or a cold HDD. It can be either magnetic or it can be either general purpose SSD or it can be provisional IOPS SSD. You cannot make throughput HDD as a root volume. Okay. So this is one issue as far of hard disk is considered. So now we'll go deeper into one by one. We will try to understand what is the use case of each and every variety of hard disk that we have. So if you take about magnetic, see in case of magnetic, let me open the console. See, now you can see here, this is my root volume. So this is my root volume. In my root volume, I had only three options. One is general purpose SSD, provisioned IOPS SSD, and magnetic. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And so this was the device configuration which I was talking about. Okay, I have chosen a Windows operating system now. So Windows can be associated only in /dev/SDA, okay? And this one is the snapshot ID where my Windows is going to get installed. And this is size. Okay, size is only 30 GB is free of cost. Rest everything will be chargeable. Okay, IOPS, we'll talk about it. I'll come to it. Throughput also, I'll come to it. Now, if I say delete on termination, it means, for example, I have launched my EC2 instance. I'm using this EC2 instance for 8 hours. Okay. After 8 hours, I'm clicking stop. If I'm saying stop, what will happen is my EC2 instance will be shut down. My EC2 instance will be shut down, but all the resources that I opted for, that is AMI, RAM, CPU, everything will be there on my AWS servers only. Okay. So what I should do is I should click terminate. If I say terminate, it means my OS will be shut down. My EC2 instance will be shut down. And all my resources will also be removed. Okay. Now, if I say delete on termination, yes, it means as soon as I terminate my EC2 instance, right, the data stored in my root volume will also get deleted.
Okay.
So if I do not check this option, then what will happen is my EC2 will get deleted, but my volume will be still on the AWS servers. I'll be paying for the AWS servers only. Okay, if you want to use the data again, or if you want to attach your volume to another EC2 instance in your account, then you can go for that particular option. Okay?
Okay.
Now, there is an option called encryption here. Okay, so encryption is actually like, you know, here, the default encryption mechanism used by AWS is AES. AWS uses AES key. Okay, this is the default. Okay, so if you do not want to use the encryption keys given by AWS, If, for example, you have purchased your keys from your certificate authority and then you have your own encryption algorithm that is to be preferred, then what you can do is, there is a service called KMS. KMS stands for Key Management System. Okay. So you can upload your certificate on KMS and you can create your own encryption algorithm and you can apply the same encryption algorithm and then encrypt your hard disk. Okay.
Okay.
So KMI is completely a free of charge. There's no charge. So you should only purchase a key from a CA. Amazon themselves a CA. You can also purchase it from Amazon if you want something like that. Okay.
Okay.
So you can have n number of keys. Like for example, you have like 20 volumes in your account. So you can have 20 different keys for encryption. There is no limit in it. But one volume can be encrypted only with a single key. So there is no concept of double encryption. Okay, in our firewalls we have, right? Offloading or dual encryption. So those concept is not, AWS do not have it. So now I'm trying to add a new volume. Okay. So new volume is something where I have to store my data. Okay. Now,
okay.
See, I have five different options for my new volume. The first one is magnetic. Standard one. Okay. So now let me go to the volume screen. I'm sorry, it's here. Now I'll say create volume. So first I'll talk about magnetic. In magnetic, okay, you see here, the minimum size that you can opt for is only 1 GB. Minimum size. And the maximum size is just 1 TB. So you cannot go beyond 1 TB on your magnetic drive. Okay. In magnetic, there is no concept of input output per second. There is no concept of throughput also. Okay, it is just a basic drive where it is completely used for doing a backup. Okay, for taking a backup. It is completely low performance and very, very cheap. Okay, it is completely cheap as far as your other volumes are considered. Okay. So if you are not worried about the performance or if you are not worried about the consistency of operation, then you can go for magnetic drives. Okay. But note this point here, like it should be on the same availability zone. See now, for example, if I'm creating this volume in US East 1A, then the EC2 instance also I should create in 1A only. Okay. Now the next one is, we'll discuss about HDDs. First we'll talk about throughput optimized HDD. So as the name indicates, this is actually a low cost. Okay. So low cost in the sense, this is higher cost as far as magnet is considered. But it is low cost as far as STD is considered. Okay. Low cost. And this is actually, it is used for frequently accessed data. It is used for frequency accessed data. I think you would have heard about this, right? So we call something like hot data, warm data and cold data. Have you heard about these things?
Not much, but yeah.
Okay, okay. Yeah. No. Like, let me tell you. I'll tell you in short. Like, you know, see, when I say hot data is something like, see, for example, see, now I have received a ticket. Okay, I'm a TAC engineer. Mm-hmm. Now I have received a ticket. So I'm logging into the system at morning 8 o'clock. As soon as I log into the system, I'm receiving a ticket and I'm working on that particular ticket. Okay, when I say, when I'm working on that particular ticket, all the files associated to the ticket will be hot data as far as me, my data is considered. Okay?
Right.
Now, the ticket priority is of 5 hours. The ticket priority is of 5 hours. Now I have crossed my third hour. 3 hours I am working. Okay. So right. If I say 3 hours, if I am working, then around 60 to 70% of the ticket would have been completed, right? I would have completed some work. Then what happens is that becomes a warm data for me. Okay. At the same time, if I am accepting another ticket, for example, another ticket is getting on the system, is falling on the system, and I'm accepting that. Okay, so the second ticket will become hot and my first ticket will become warm. Okay. Now I have my warm ticket with me. Now the 5 hours priority has been, the time has been over. I have completed the ticket and I have submitted the ticket also.
Okay.
Okay. If I have submitted the ticket, at least for next 3 days, the ticket will be in warm condition only. Okay.
Okay.
So after 3 days, the first ticket which I have accepted will become cold.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So this type of ticketing system is followed in mostly all the companies. If you talk about data, see, for example, you are giving me an Excel file. Okay. And right. You are asking mm-hmm. me to fill some details on that Excel file. And I'm mm-hmm. very seriously working on that particular Excel file. Okay. Mm-hmm. So that Excel file is hot for me. Now, for 5 days, I'm using that Excel file. And I have almost completed. I have neared around 90% of completion. So then the data becomes warm data for me.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. After next like 30 days later, I will never think about the Excel sheet which you have given me before 30 days. Okay. So that mm-hmm. data becomes cold data.
Okay.
So this is the normal practice which is followed in storage. See, why I'm saying this is, the reason is, like, you know, as far as storage concepts are considered, see, every file is meant for backupping, right?
Mm-hmm.
So in backup, we will be following this architecture. This is a kind of an architecture which we use. Okay, so assume that you have a plan to set up a huge database service for your office. Okay, so you have around like 10,000 employees in your office who are working in multiple branches, different locations, and everybody has to use a particular database. Okay, so when I say there are 10,000 employees, every user will be uploading and downloading from that particular database only. Correct?
Okay.
So that database should be maintained as best as possible. Even if one single data is lost, then mostly all the 10,000 employees will get affected. So it is a very important server that we have, right? So what we do is, mm-hmm. while Amazon recommends this particular architecture, what they do is, when you launch a database, they will ask, they ask us to launch the database on provisioned IOP system. Because I said there are 10,000 employees, that too from different locations, not from the same location.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So launch your database on provisioned IOPS. So your database services will be running on provision day ops. Now, for example, first 5 days is been over. So the database size would have increased, right? Now you have to take a backup. Now take a backup on general purpose SSD. A little bit a lower performance than your provision day ops system. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Now 10 days has crossed. So what will I do for the first 2 days data? I will put it to the throughput optimized hard disk. I'll go for throughput optimized hard disk. Okay. Which is some bit lower than that of general purpose SSD. Okay. Now from throughput STD, again, 15 days has been over. Now I want to take a backup. So only less percentage of people will be using it. So I will move it to cold HDD. Okay. From cold HDD, I'll not move it to magnetic because magnetic, the size is very less, right? I will move it to a different object storage file system, which is S3. So this is how we practice as far as storage is considered in AWS. Okay. So this is the one which we were following in our implementation. Because the cost variations is like that. So provisioned IOPS is very high cost and very high performance. And next comes the general purpose SSD. Next comes the throughput optimized hard disk. Next comes the cold hard disk. Okay, then next comes the magnetic. If you do not want to use magnetic, then you can go for an object storage system. So in object storage system also, we have the same kind of architecture. There are like different storage flavors in S3, which Amazon provides. Okay.
Okay.
Any questions here? We will go deeper one by one.
No, I'm good. Yeah.
Just give it 2 minutes. I'll just have some water and come back.
Oh, okay. Come up.
So now we were talking about general throughput optimized HDD, right? See, this is actually, this hard disk is designed for like a good amount of, you can say like, you know, frequently accessed data. Okay. So if your performance, if you want your performance to be medium, you do not want a high performance system. Okay. Your medium performance system, but still you want to have a frequency of accessing the data, more data at more time, then you can go for throughput optimization. Okay. So this is especially for workloads like where, you know, fast workloads. So you want more kind of throughput. For that kind of system, you can use here. Use the throughput optimized systems. Or for example, if you want to use some big data systems, right? You can go for throughput optimized. Or if you want something like, for example, data warehousing. Okay, for data warehousing, you can go for Crypto-Devised. Or you want to store all your logs in one place, and after that you have to process the logs, right? Then you can go for Throughput Optimized. So these are the variety of workloads that you can use on Throughput Optimized. Okay. Now, so as I said, now what is the minimum size? The minimum size is 500 GB. And the maximum size is 16 TB. Okay, you can go up to 16 TB.
Yeah. So here, GIB and GB both are same, right? Actually, we discussed.
No, it is actually 0.93.
Okay, yeah.
GIB. Yeah, it is 0.93 GB. GIB is lesser than.
Not less than GB.
Mm-hmm. That's what 16384, right? So it is like 16384 GIB to TB. If I say it is around like 17 TB discount.
No, okay.
Now, there is something called as throughput. So what is throughput? Mm-hmm. Now, throughput is something like this. For example, see, I'm giving you some options here. So you are going to shop for purchasing hard disks.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I'm asking you to purchase a 1 GB hard disk. This is my storage limit, which I have given to you. You're going to a shop. Now the shopkeeper is saying, I have 1 GB hard disk, which has 3200 RPM. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And I have an 1 GB hard disk, which has 7200 RPM. So which one you will go for?
Yeah, Mac, definitely above one, right?
You'll go for the second one, right? Because the RPM, yeah. Rotation per minute. So you have that the disk and the spindle, right? If your disk rotation is very fast, then your throughput will be really good. Correct?
Right. Yeah.
Now, for example, I'm giving you another example. See, now you have, I have asked you to purchase this. Now I'm giving you another hard disk also. For example, 10 GB. 7200, and you have 100 GB, 7200 RPM, 1 TB, 7200 RPM. Which one is faster? I'm not talking in the case of size, I'm talking in the perspective of fast speed. Which one is faster?
Maybe 10 GB.
This one. So 10 GB will be faster, correct?
Yeah.
Because the storage space is less, but the RPM is very fast. The rotation is very fast. So retrieving will be really good, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Now, as far as this throughput optimized HDD is considered, per 1 TB, the throughput will be 40 MB per second.
Okay.
So now, you have opted for a 500 GB hard disk. Okay. So I said per TB, 40 Mbps is the maximum size. Now, if you go for 500 GB, then 20 MB will be the maximum throughput, right?
All right.
So that is what, that is why here the base, it is automatically taking as 20 Mbps.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So now I'll increase this slightly. See here what happens. So now, for example, I'm increasing it as 550. See now what happens? The throughput automatically changes. Okay. So for 50 GB hard disk extra, I'm giving it 2 Mbps of throughput extra. Okay.
Right.
So now, for example, I'm going for 1 TB. So now the throughput automatically changes. Okay.
Right.
So it is 391. So the throughput is calculated based on the size that you are opting for. Okay, so what is the maximum throughput supported in this case? If you go for 16384, the maximum throughput supported is only 500 Mbps, not more than that. You cannot go more than that. Okay?
Okay.
Now, the next one is cold HDD. See, as the name indicates, cold HDD is for cold data. It means the data at rest, the data which is at rest, okay, which will not be frequently accessed by users. Okay.
Okay.
So in storage, this is actually really a confusing term. People will call it as like hot, cold data, warm, cold data. Cold data. There are many, many things in storage actually. So if I go to EMC Square, you will be like completely confused. Okay, right. We call it as like, you know, there is a company called EMC, right? EMC2. Now Dell has acquired it.
Correct.
We call this system as EMC Square data system. Sorry, EMC Square formula. Right. So how are you going to backup each and every file? So for example, now if I'm managing a backup for the entire team of 20 people, right?
Right.
So in 20 people, there will be different kind of workers, correct? So there will be one guy who is into development. There will be one guy who is into testing. There will be one guy who is taking care of the meetings between the developer team and the testing team. Right?
Right.
So everyone will be having their own data with them, right? So how to back up each and every data? That's how the calculation goes. Okay.
Correct.
So we do not want to go much deeper into it because it will be really confusing. It will take a lot amount of time to understand. It is not needed for you also. You're not going to become a storage engineer after this, right? So that is a different cup of tea. Okay.
Okay.
So cold HDD is something you can remember like this. Cold HDD is for something like the data at rest. Okay. So now, for example, I'm downloading AWS videos from internet. Okay.
Right.
When I'm downloading AWS videos from internet, I know I'll be interested to learn from first chapter to from first chapter, second chapter, third chapter. I'll go like that. Right. So till I go to 29th chapter, my 30th chapter is just cold data, right? I'm not going to open it regularly, correct?
Right.
So first I'm going to use first chapter. I'm going to repeat it. I'm going to revise it. First, I'll try to understand my first chapter. After that, I'll read my second chapter. So what will happen to the first chapter after I reading? That will become cold again. Okay, it is like that. So cold is for the data which are less frequently accessed, or you can say not even accessed. Such kind of data will become cold data.
Okay.
See, for example, you are giving your appraisal presentation PPT to your manager. Okay. So the appraisal presentation of year 2020 March, will it be a hot data at 2025 March? No, right? That will become a cold data. Correct?
Yeah.
So such kind of data will be stored on cold hard disks. Okay. So it is specially used for storage purpose only. If I want to dump something, if I want to archive something, such kind of things, I will be doing it on cold HDD.
Okay.
Right? So the places where you do not want to spend on storage, there you will go for cold HDD.
Right.
Now, see the limit of throughput allocated also. See there, the baseline was 40 Mbps, right?
Correct.
In throughput optimized, it was 40 Mbps, and here it is just 12 Mbps. And the maximum is only 250. Even if I go for 16384, I will not be able to reach 250 speed. So it is very, very slow. It is like having a 10 GB hard disk with 720 RPM, which is very, very slow.
Okay.
Right? Now, we'll go for general purpose SSD. See here, the size is minimum is 1 GB, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So what is the use for general purpose? So general purpose SSD is like balanced price and balanced performance, average performance. Okay? So it is good for everybody. It is good for any kind of systems. See, for example, you want to run your database. Okay, so you want to run your virtual desktops, or you want to run your firewalls, or you want to run your softwares. For everything, this general purpose SSD is really good, recommended. Okay, one more advantage, you can use it as a root volume also. So that is also one advantage here.
Okay.
Okay, now, so in SSDs, seen only in hard disks, we use the terminology of throughput, okay? But SSDs, we do not use the terminology of throughput. In SSD, we call it with IOPS. Okay, so IOPS is input output per second. I hope you know the architecture, right? So SSD will look like this. See, SSD is like a film, okay? It's a film on which there will be a kind of a stick, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So this stick is your read-write head. The stick is your read-write head. And hard disks will look like this. It will be an iron plate. On that, there will be a read write head.
Okay.
So here what happens is this plate rotates and the read write head will be standing at a place. It will be moving like this to and fro motion.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And this one will be rotating. Here what happens is the read write hit head will be moving here and there, and the film never moves. This is a static item. Okay. So now, for example, the read write head is like this. So my data is here. So what will happen is this read write head will move here and then it will read the data. My data is here. My data is here, so my read write head will move, and then here it will be like, it will read the particular data. Okay?
All right.
Yeah. Give me 1 minute, I'm getting an urgent call. 1 minute.
Hey, no problem.
Yes, Satya, I'm back here.
Oh, okay.
So you understand this, right? That's why actually like here what we do is like per second, what is the input given on the film and what is the output taken out of the film? That's why we use this terminology of IOPS.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the minimum is 1 GB. The maximum is 16384 and 70 GB it comes. Okay. And see the baseline here. The baseline is 3 IOPS per GB and the minimum is 1100 IOPS. So for example, if you are choosing 1 GB, then this will be having a 100 IOPS operation speed. Okay?
Okay.
Now, for example, what will happen if I go for 2 GB space? 2 GB also, the minimum will be 100 only.
Okay.
The minimum will be 100. For example, if I go for 5 GB, again the minimum will be 100. If I go for 10 GB, the minimum will be 100. See, for example, I'm going for 11 GB, then again the minimum is 100 only. Okay. So, for example, like, you know, 11 GB into 3. 11 into 3 is 33, right?
Right.
See, for example, I'm going for 100 GB. So 100 into 3 will be 300 GB, okay? 300 IOPS. So now, what is the maximum here? The maximum is 16,000. That is the maximum limit.
Okay.
Okay. So you cannot go beyond this. 16,000 is the maximum limit.
Mm-hmm.
The next one is provisioned IOPS SSD. Now, what is the difference between general purpose SSD and provisioned IOPS SSD? So general purpose SSD is something like, it is also a really a fast system, but compared to general purpose, provisioned IOPS is even faster. Okay. It is even faster. So you want a really a very like dynamic system or a fast operating system, then you can go for provisioned IOPS. The cost is also very, very high in this case.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So many companies cannot afford to go for a provisioned IOPS system.
Okay.
See here, the option here is actually you can set your IOPS limit. It is completely up to you. See, for example, now for say the minimum itself is 4 GB only. Okay, you cannot go for a 1 GB provisioned IOPS system. Okay, the minimum itself is 4 GB. See, for example, I'm going for 4. Okay, for 4 minimum, they will give it for 100 IOPS. Now, for example, for 4 GB of system, can I set a good amount of speed? So they are making it as 50:1 ratio. For example, I'll say like I want 300 IOPS. Oh, this is also not working. Okay, I'll go for 40 GB. Yeah. See, 40 GB, 40 into 3 is 120. Correct? So my IOPS can be 120 only. But what I am doing here, I am setting a 300 IOPS here.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. For example, I am opting for a 400 GB hard disk. For 400 GB. Like 400 into 3,200, right? I can go for only 1200 IOPS. But for example, I'm going for 7,200 IOPS.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I can vary my operating speed based on my requirement.
Okay,
so little amount of storage, more IOPS. So my performance will be very, very good. That is the idea.
Okay. Yeah. And for these parameters, what are the parameters we are changing? And there is a change in performance.
There will be a change in the performance also.
Yeah.
It is like the second example which I told you.
Right.
10 GB, but 1 GB hard disk, 7200 RPM.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So if you want to go for more storage, you can go for it, or if you want to go for less storage but faster option, you can again go for it. Okay. So now, how does Amazon would have achieved this particular setup? That is completely because of these two concepts. The concept of having RAID, redundant array of independent disks. Okay, RAID, and there is a concept called LVM, local volume mounting. Okay, so these are the two concepts which are behind actually this volumes, hard disks.
Okay.
Okay, so now you will be seeing this particular option everywhere. So what is this? This is nothing but a backup of your volume. So what kind of backup is it? Is it an incremental backup or a differential backup? So this snapshot is an incremental backup actually. Okay. Now, for example, you have a volume of 30 GB size, 30 GB size. Now you have to take a backup of it. So the snapshot also will be 30 GB only. Okay, now you want to use this snapshot and you want to create a new volume. Now this volume that you have created out of the snapshot can be more than that of 30 GB. Okay, so what is this? See, for example, I'm giving you a 500 GB hard disk. Okay, and I'm asking you to take a backup. So what you're doing, you are purchasing a 500 GB hard disk and you are doing a backup from my first disk to a second disk. Now, the original disk is somehow damaged. Now you are only having the backup disk with you. That is disk number two. Now, I'm asking you to copy this 500 GB data to another hard disk. So what you can do, you can either copy it to a 500 GB hard disk, or you can copy it to a 1 TB hard disk also, right? It is possible, correct? Now, that is what this concept is all about. Now, when you take a backup of your volume to snapshot, the size will never change. The size will be same only. When you take a backup from your snapshot, when you restore the backup, the snapshot size can be incremented and it can be loaded to a single volume. Okay. So now what I say is snapshot is again a same kind of a persistent volume only. It is also a persistent volume. Okay. This also has the same characteristics of your volume. It is also same as your volume. So what is a snapshot? Snapshot is nothing but a incremental backup of all your data stored in your volumes. Okay, so you can do anything with your data after you successfully backed it up. Okay, you can either mount it or you can keep it safe and you can mount it to a different EC2 instance. You can do whatever you want. Okay. So now, you have an internal hard disk you are backing up your data from your internal hard disk to your external hard disk. So you can use this external hard disk in anywhere. There is no restriction. So from your PC, you can connect it to your laptop, you can connect it to your TV, you can connect it to your mobile, you can connect it to your iPad, you can use it in any way. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So you can have multiple backups on your external hard disk. There is no restriction that you should only have a backup of this particular data, right? You can have any kind of data. Okay?
Right.
Okay. So now let me show you like how to attach an EC2, attach a create a volume and attach it to an instance. See, for example, I'll go for.
So for all these softwares or hardwares, what they're trying to do is, they need to be a some physical hard disk, right? At AWS, Amazon need to maintain that.
Yes.
Yeah. And so one hard disk, they are dividing into the partitions based on the sizes which we are ordering.
No, it is not kind of a partition. It is like this actually. See, what happens is, when I say servers, see, I said you servers, right? Inside your availability zones, there can be data centers. And inside your data centers, there can be servers. See, for example, your servers are like this. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
For example, I have four servers. Okay. Now this server has 8 GB of RAM and 1 TB of storage. 8 GB of RAM and 1 TB of storage. 16 GB of RAM and 1 TB of storage. Now, for example, if I use my network card, if I connect all these servers together. Okay, then what happens is I can only perform data sharing. Okay, see, for example, I'm having a laptop, you are having a laptop, we both are taking a LAN card and we are connecting both of our laptops. So what we can do, I can only do a data sharing. Can I use your RAM and into my system RAM? It is not possible, right? But here, what is happening is, they have used a driver. It is a special hardware. It is called as LVM hardware, okay, or RAID hardware. It's a special hardware. It is a chip card kind of a stuff. And what they have done is this, they have taken a SATA. I think you might have used this SATA. You would have seen this SATA in your desktops.
Right.
It will be a red color tape.
Mm-hmm.
And all these servers are attached to your hardware here. Now, what is happening is data sharing is not happening, resource sharing is happening. Okay, so the resource itself is being shared. Now, it is not 8 GB, it is not 8 GB, it is actually 32 GB server. So it is not individual servers, it is one single logical server. It is a single server because all the resources are being shared.
Okay.
So now, for example, you have two motherboards with you. And you have four hard disks with you. Now, two hard disks you are attaching to this motherboard, and two hard disks you are attaching to a second motherboard. So it means there are two different systems, right?
Right.
Here, what you're doing is, in this operation, what is happening is, in one single motherboard, all the four hard disks are added. So what happens? It is one single system only. It is one single logical system only.
Right. Okay.
So now it is like the state is available. Now I have created a volume of 8 GB size. Very similar process. There is nothing speciality involved over here. Okay.
Okay.
Oh, now I didn't check that one. Like, that is the problem here. Now see, this is actually in US East 1D. Now my volume is in 1A. Okay, I'll delete this. Now this is the only thing which you have to remember while attaching it.
Okay.
So now you can go ahead and you can say like attach volume, and you can select your instance. That's it.
Oh, okay.
You can click attach, it will get attached. Okay. So tomorrow we will go to a different service. We will talk about S3. Okay.
Okay. Sure.
So that is also a storage service only. After that, we will come to network and security. Separately, we will come to network and security. So there are like no concepts because you have to understand about what is VPC, how they are distributed. So those things are there. So S3 will take up to like 2 classes, I think it will take.
Okay.
So we'll complete S3 and then we'll complete IAM and then we will go to VPC.
Oh, okay. Sure. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay then. So tomorrow also 7:30, right? 7:30 PM.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Bye-bye.